It's a real pleasure to be here today and to discuss a little bit our program that is focusing on an HIV vaccine, prophylactic vaccine. I obviously have a conflict of interest because the name of the title of the session was The Pipeline. I thought it's a nice opportunity to show you the pipeline of Janssen vaccines. We are still a development company. We have several vaccines in development. I will focus today on the HIV vaccine. The prophylactic HIV vaccine. We also have a therapeutic HIV vaccine in development and also focus on respiratory diseases, pathogens of global concern, and also have a bacterial vaccine franchise. Apart from that, Janssen is also still committed to improvements on the management of HIV patients. I will not go into that. That's really something that I leave up to my colleagues. So despite huge improvements on the management of HIV patients, there is still an unmet need in the prevention of HIV. I apologize for figures of 2017, but at that year we still counted 1.8 new infections, and we are waiting for the 2018 numbers that hopefully will show a positive impact of PrEP. But still, this shows that there is a need in the prevention of HIV, and it's recognized that a vaccine, a prophylactic protective vaccine, will contribute to that effort to prevent HIV overall. So based on quite some preclinical studies, we came up with a palette of tools that we think is needed to achieve the immune response and the... Am I back? Yes, sorry, I will not touch it again. We came up with a toolbox things to generate that optimal immune response that can hopefully give protection against HIV infection, and these are viral vectors. We have an adenoviral vector platform, and we also have MVA as a viral vector to deliver HIV antigens, GEC, POL, and ENV, and these are mosaic antigens to get immune responses that will be covering against all HIV clades that are circulating around the globe. And finally, we have a trimeric protein that we add in the vaccine to get optimal humoral immune responses, because from earlier studies we have seen that humoral immunity is the strongest correlate of protection in non-human primates. So, of course, how do you select then a regimen from all these compounds that that you can take further into efficacy studies? And I can assure you that this plan took quite some time to come up with, but we decided to do in parallel an efficacy study in non-human primates and an immunogenicity study in people to see whether we could get an immune correlate out of the monkey studies and then look whether that regimen in people also gave the similar type of immune responses so that we could use it sort of a proof of concept of the regimen that we would take further. So the regimen that we were going to apply, or the regimens, it was in the end an 8-arm study in people. So we used a mixture of 4 adenoviral vectors, 2 of them expressing mosaic GEC-POL antigens, and 2 of them expressing ENV mosaic antigens. And then there were 2 vaccinations that either had, again, the mixture, or the mixture plus protein, or protein alone, or MVA plus protein. So this was quite an extensive study, but to emphasize, so everybody received the first 2 shots was the same. It was the adeno mixture, and the diversification occurred in the 3rd and 4th vaccine dose. So as you will appreciate, for the non-human primate studies, we were ready to go when we had the materials ready. For the human studies, of course, we had to go a little bit more carefully to have first in human studies for the different components separately. So we had a study for the MVA vector, we had a separate study first for the protein, and then finally in the so-called approach study, we compared these 8 regimens, and this was the first in human study for the adeno component. So, of course, we needed to do the CTM manufacturing, and as it has always been with the 3rd reviewer, in our case, it was the 4th vector that could not be produced. This was a major drawback, of course, in the program, because we wanted to stick to our timelines. And while we were investigating what the problem was, it turned out that this fourth vector did not express the antigen, and as a consequence, we had accumulation of ENF protein during the manufacturing process, which was not compatible with production of the vector. We had to come up with a solution. So clearly the problem was that we could not use that fourth vector, that was an ENF expressing vector, and that was mainly giving the clade C responses, so quite significant to have in your vaccine. We came up with an interim solution that was to go forward without this vector and double the dose of the ENF vector that could be produced. And we worked on a durable solution to develop an alternative vector expressing this clade C type MOS2-ENF insert. So the approach study that I showed you with what was the plan, where we were going to use four adenoviral vectors in the immune regimen, we changed it because we could not produce that fourth vector into this regimen. So we had two GEC-POL expressing vectors, and we used a double dose of the ENF expressing vector. So the design of the non-human primate study is shown here. As I said, two times the adeno mixture, and then followed by adeno plus protein, adeno alone, MVA plus protein, MVA alone, or protein alone, and all compared to a placebo group. And for the human study, we had exactly the same arms, but we included two additional arms with a low-dose protein to also have a dose-finding component in the human immunogenicity study. So these are the results of the non-human primate study. In this case, as I said, we could do challenges of the monkeys. So after completion of the vaccination regimen, we waited a couple of months, and then we exposed the animals weekly to an intrarectal dose with the SHIF SF162P3. And you can see here that one of the regimens, which was the two times adeno mixture followed by two times adeno plus protein mixture, gave us a 94% per exposure risk reduction, and in the end, after completion of the challenge series, gave us 67% of protected animals. In this study, we could look for correlates of protection, and it turned out that antibodies and T cells directed against HIV envelope were strong correlates of protection. And when we looked at the functionality of antibodies, it turned out that ADCP, so antibody-dependent cellular phagocytosis, was the strongest functional correlate of protection. As I said, we had the study ongoing in parallel in humans, and I'm only showing here the data for the same regimen, which also was the so-called winning regimen in humans. So at you can see, oh, now I can do that trick with the pointer. No, let's not go there. So the orange line shows the immunogenicity in the right side of the slide in non-human primates. So you can see that things go down and up again when we give the additional dose. And in blue, you can see the same line for this vaccination regimen in people. And at the time of SHIF challenge in the non-human primates, you can see that the immunogenicity in people was actually even higher. And also, we have now more long-term data is it's showing that the immune response is durable, so we have good hopes that we stay for quite some time above protective levels in non-human primates. So while we were doing these studies, the discovery team worked on the durable solution, in other words, trying to develop an additional vector. And they managed to do that. So we have a new vector called MOS2S, S for substitute. And this vector was very well expressed, and also in preclinical studies showed an increase of breadth and magnitude of immune responses that convinced our compound development team to think of a way to catch up and bring this vector into the regimen before we would move into efficacy studies. So to do that, we had to go from the regimen that we had tested in approach to the MOS4 regimen, where we would introduce the fourth vector. And this is what we did in an additional clinical study, the so-called TRAVERSE study, which was a randomized parallel group placebo-controlled double-blind phase 1-2A study, where we compared the 3 adeno regimen with the 4 adeno regimen. So it was 2 times adeno mixture followed by 2 times adeno plus protein. In the original plan, we planned for 4, approach was with 3, and now we moved back to 4 vectors. So to show what it looked like, we had the blue one was the regimen that we tested in the approach study. The green regimen is the new regimen with the 4th vector. And you can see we powered the study immediately to have sufficient safety data to move on to an efficacy trial should the data look good enough. And it did. So here you can see the data, the humoral immune response of M-specific serum titers in ELISA. The blue dots represent post-second and post-third dose of the so-called approach regimen, where we had only 1 vector-expressing envelope. In green, you can see the improvement over this regimen. So by adding a fourth vector or the second M-expressing vector, we saw quite an increase in the ELISA titer of M-specific antibodies. Here you can see the comparison of functionalities of these antibodies and also the breadth of the response. So the dotted line in the middle is what we put as the comparator of the approach study. And you can see that all the responses that were achieved with the 4-valent adeno were improving over that. You can see that there's not so much an improvement of the clade B-specific responses, but this component was already in the approach regimen. And we were only checking this carefully because we did not want the 4th vector to, of course, interfere with these clade B responses and to have impaired responses there. So this was really a very good outcome, and also the functionality, as you can see in ADCP against different clade viruses, still looked very promising. Also, the cellular responses against envelope were improved. You can see again here the green dots representing the 4-valent regimen as compared to the trivalent regimen in blue. So the conclusions of this TRAVERSE study, where we compared the 4-valent regimen with the trivalent regimen, is that it was safe. We did this disaster check, as we called it, after 3 doses, because we really wanted to get started with a proof of concept study. So after 3 doses, we had a very favorable safety profile. We had very good humoral immune responses, even broader than what we had seen in the approach study. And also the tetravalent composition gave stronger and specific cellular immunity than what we had seen with the trivalent. So how do you then move from early development to efficacy trials? Because of course you can imagine that becomes very expensive, and also you will expose a quite significant number of healthy volunteers to a regimen. So we went back to our non-human primate data and plotted the animals on a graph where we compared T-cell responses on the y-axis, humoral responses on the x-axis, and we plotted the animals. So the blue dots are the animals that were infected after that were protected after completion of the challenge series, and the red dots represent animals that became infected. And you will immediately appreciate that we see enrichment of protected animals in that upper right quadrant, where animals had high T-cell responses and high humoral immune responses. So based on this, we set criteria for the human study to see whether we had sufficient people also accumulating in that upper right quadrant based on their immune responses. And we set criteria that 60% needed to be either in the high enough T-cell response group or in the high enough humoral response group, and 40% of participants needed to be in that upper right quadrant. Only if we would achieve that, based on immunogenicity, we would proceed with a proof of concept efficacy study. So this is the data of the approach study, where we had only 1 adeno env vector, right, the trivalent. This is the criteria that we had preset, so we needed to have 40% in that upper right quadrant, and we were very happy to see that 64% of participants participants in the APPROACH study were already showing sufficient immunogenicity, immune responses to move forward. And I can tell you that not all regimens that we tested met these criteria, so it's not that we used a low bar. Then we did the same analysis for the data that came out of TRAVERSE, where we had the four-valent adeno mixture, and this looked even better. We had 94% of participants in this study accumulating in this upper right quadrant, meaning that they had immune responses that were above the threshold that we had set for potentially being protective in people. So this gave us sufficient confidence to convince our senior management to proceed with a phase 2B study in southern Africa. This study is being executed in sexually active HIV uninfected women aged 18 to 35 years, as this is really a group in these countries that is known for high incidence of HIV infection. As I said, we are using the 2x adeno mix followed by 2x adeno plus protein, and we will evaluate the efficacy of the vaccine regimen in reducing the incidence of HIV infection in women. And our hypothesis to date is that we want to see 50% efficacy, so 50% reduction in HIV acquisition. It's a double-blind, one-to-one randomized trial. We are enrolling, and we really hope to be able to announce completion of enrollment soon. Of course, we are also preparing for a phase 3 study. Here we realized that we probably need further improvement of our clade B humoral responses. So we have introduced now a second protein, so it's becoming even more complex from a manufacturing point of view, especially. And we have succeeded in making that a protein. Of course, the decision to include that is on one end, you need to show expansion of your breath. On the other hand, you need to show that it's not interfering with the responses that you already had with your original regimen. We are currently testing that in the so-called ASCEND study, where we compare the regimen with one protein with a regimen with two proteins and compare it to placebo, also to have immediately sufficient safety data. The regimen has stayed the same, and we are desperately waiting to disclose that data as well. So to close with, I realize we have still a couple of challenges ahead. We are taking quite some risk by having a phase 2B study without data and already planning for a phase 3 study in other geographies to really build the case that our vaccine has a global protective potential. Of course, that's what we hope for. But we have good reasons to believe. Of course, we are all aware of the RV144 trial that was the first efficacy trial that showed some efficacy, only 31%. But when we repeated that regimen in the same non-human primate challenge model that we have been using, we only observed a 29% per exposure risk reduction. And of course, this sort of validates the non-human primate model. So based on our 94% per exposure risk reduction in the same model, we have sort of reasons to believe, and this is not a forward-looking statement, it's just a scientific reason to believe that our vaccine has the potential to work. I would like to thank our collaborators and partners. This is, I think they say it takes a village. I think here it takes the world to achieve this. We have excellent collaborations with academia. We receive financial and scientific support from NIAID, HVTN, and also from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and also other institutions have helped us and worked with us along the way. These are the people at Janssen, and each name represents 100 people behind them who are working on this program. And of course, I would like to end with thanking all the investigators in the field, and especially all participants that volunteer to be part of our study with, and they are highly motivated, I can tell you. So thank you for your attention.